Oh, hey, Rhys, what's going on today?
Executive officer for the week.
Yes.
But all the decisions of that officer have to be ratified at a special bi-weekly meeting.
Yes, I see.
By a simple majority in the case of purely internal affairs.
Be quiet.
But by a two-thirds majority in the case of more...
Be quiet. I order you to be quiet.
Look, you stupid bastard, you've got no arms left.
Yes, I have.
Look!
Just a flesh wound.
I don't believe I've seen such a display of courage, skill, nerve, grace, and stupidity.
I'll do you for that.
Oh, what?
Come here. What are you going to do, bleed on me? I'm invincible.
You're a loony.
The Black Knight always triumphs.
Roundtable Live, Monday through Friday, 1 a.m. till 4 a.m. Eastern Time. Bring your mind, bring your ideas, bring your voice. King Arthur had nothing on us. Here, Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com.
Don't make me angry. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry.
See how the trouble you've started?
Join us here on Revolution Radio, Monday through Friday, 2 p.m. Eastern on Studio B, for a politician, patriot, social savant, businessman, former investment banker, and Veterans Today columnist, Mike Harris. Listen to Mike as he exposes the corruption, sedition, and terrorism within our own government. He knows our system is flawed and that obstruction of justice is all too commonplace. His show, Short End of the Stick, pokes at this corruption with eloquent style. That's Monday through Friday, 2 p.m. Studio B, for the Short End of the Stick with the man who should have been elected governor of Arizona, Mike Harris.
That's right here on Revolution Radio. The opinions expressed on this radio station, its programs, and its website by the hosts, guests, and call-in listeners or chatters are solely the opinions of the original source who expressed them. They do not necessarily represent the opinions of Revolution Radio and FreedomSlips.com, its staff, or affiliates. You're listening to Revolution Radio, FreedomSlips.com, 100% listener-supported radio, and now we return you to your host.
Good evening, this is Sheila Kennedy from Queensland in Australia, and we're the 1st of October, and this is my very first show for my second year with Revolution Radio. So last week was my last one for that year, and I actually started with Revolution Radio a year tomorrow. So I'm excited about starting my second year and being connected with some wonderfully amazing people around the world. So it gives me great pleasure to join you on Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com this evening. And Revolution Radio is the number one 100% listener-supported radio station bringing tonight's show to you. And as I said, it's the 1st of October and it's 6 p.m. here in Queensland in Australia. So what or why, I'm asked, is the 1%? Why did I call my show Welcome to the 1%? And I often say to people that as a spiritual and metaphysical practitioner and teacher, I've been well aware that my message and my beliefs will in many instances fall on deaf ears, and that it really is around 1% of the population who actually think outside the box or outside the square, and who are actually open-minded enough to question what others often take for granted or as an absolute unquestionable truth simply because X, Y, or Z said so. So having an inquiring mind, I'm constantly searching for information, and I have a need and a desire to know more and then to be able to share that information with those people that I find on my journey who are willing to listen. So welcome if you're with us tonight in person, if you're in the chat room. There's some wonderful people tonight in the chat room. Dory Bar, Noodles, Jer Bear, Banjo Picking Gal. I can see a few people already logged in and having a chat. And if you're not in the chat room, please come and join us. Or if you're listening online, or if you're going to listen to the archives later. So you are one of the 1%, and I congratulate you and welcome you as you join me this evening. And we're going to be exploring life from a different perspective. Now, I have a wonderful young guest this evening. And he's a very young guest. He's 23 days off being 23, which is exciting. I can remember being 23. So my young guest tonight is Rhys O'Leary. And Rhys lives in Sydney in Australia. And he's a psychic medium. He's intuitive. And he discovered at around age 17 that he was able to connect with and communicate with those who had passed away. And also to tap into universal records. That could be what some people might refer to as the Akashic records. And Rhys has been working for some time now, offering his knowledge and his services. So welcome, Rhys, and thank you for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
I'm excited about having you. I think this is awesome.
I need to point out just quickly, I'm actually so excited, I'm shaking. Like, that's how excited I get. I get like so, like, I think people need to realize that being a psychic medium, you experience everything in every extreme. And right now I'm just experiencing this extreme euphoric excitement. So thank you for having me.
That's awesome. And I hope you'll come back again.
Oh my God, yes.
Fantastic. And one of the things to me that's so exciting, Rhys, is how many young people. You're the third of the young people I've had in the last 4 weeks. So, you know, my young Tina, who's one of my students and my practitioners and teachers, who's also reads very, very intuitive. I had my colleague on last week. Susan's nearly as old as me, so we won't worry about her too much. that's dreadful, isn't it? And we had Scotty Z from Scotty Z TV, who's an amazing young man as well, a little older than you. And I just find it so exciting of awesome. Being an old lady, if you like, and I am.
I'm just excited just being me and with other young people, just having people like-minded around the same age that are going, I'm recognizing this too. It makes me feel less crazy.
Well, that's always good. And this is why I, as I said in my introduction, I called my show Welcome to the 1%, because there are so few options, if you like, in the past, to be able to connect with people on the same age group. I found as a child, my grandmother was Welsh and psychic. She read the tea leaves, but right. She and my grandfather were the only ones that I could connect with. My parents were very frightened of the fact that I talked mm-hmm. to dead people.
Mm-hmm. Same
and
here.
Yeah, you learn to shut up, don't you?
Yeah. And it's funny because you know my connection with my grandfather very well. So, yeah, it really is true. It's funny how we connect like that.
And, you know, your grandfather's an amazing man, and that's how I met you, of course, and he's a real sweetheart. And it's incredible, I think, that we have such elders in our lives, don't we? You know, my grandmother died when I was in my early 30s, but still walks with me every day.
I know exactly how you feel. I have that exact same connection with my great aunt. And it's I love sharing the experience with people because I think it takes a bit of awkwardness off death. And that's a lot of what I feel like I'm here to do, is take that awkwardness off death. Because I don't think people are necessarily scared of it. They just say they're scared of it because it's easier than really explaining how they actually feel about death. Because yeah. I always question people. I always say, how do you actually really feel about death? Because I know you're not scared of it. And I feel like a bit of a truth detector, and I feel like people never want to lie to me. So it's really good to help people in that sense get it out of themselves. And, yeah, so sorry.
And being able to talk about what happens when people pass and the fact that it isn't the end of the world.
Mm-hmm.
I found has been so good because, as you said, so many people say they fear death, and it may not exactly be a fear. You know, we look at false emotion appearing real as the word fear, but it's that finalness for a lot of people, isn't it? And even, you know, even in the situations that I'm sure you find yourself and I find myself in on a daily basis, you're not only talking to people personally, but you've got quite often all of the relatives that want to come in and chat at the same time.
My goodness, I can't even describe it. And it's like the bigger the beacon, the more you attract. And I don't mean that in any derogatory, you know, way at all, to put people on pedestals or anything, but it literally is. It's like the more open and the more developed you are and the more you can connect with them, the bigger your beacon is, the more you will attract.
It's
so amazing. Oh my gosh. I think the most I've ever had come through for someone, and they were a non-believer, and it was amazing because I turned them into a believer straight away, was I had 13 relatives come through, and I was keeping track of all of them. But it got a bit messy in the end, so I had to kind of just be like, yeah, okay, guys, bye. So
been there, done that, yep.
So, it's just, I find it so amazing because the more I think, oh, no, this is the limit. This is the limit. No more's ever going to come through. The more I think that, the more they prove me wrong, and I'm just like, yep, let's play this game forever because it's fun.
Well, I've often said to people, Rhys, you know, and I read professionally for many years, not in the last probably six, just occasionally, but I used to read a lot at festivals and did a stage show years ago and all sorts of things like that. But when you open that door, open that channel, that you're available to, you know, access information or receive messages, quite often you get lots and lots of people, and they're not necessarily all relatives, are they? It's just people want to share their story.
That's right.
And it's about sifting through it and finding who's actually meant to be there and who's not. And one of the stories I share with people sometimes, I was working with a guy in Victoria years ago now, probably 12, 13 years ago, called Brian Oldfield. Wonderful guy. And he had the very first face reading website on the internet. Right. And Brian was doing shopping center promotions to promote his website. It was called True Insights, I think, from memory. Now that's dreadful, isn't it? I don't remember. But anyway, we used to do shopping center promotions, but he and I would also do private sessions where we actually both worked as mediums, and we would bounce backwards and forwards, and then we would do a reading in, you know, half and half people up, and Brian would do some and I would do some for people in their homes. So we'd arranged to go to Ballarat, and you've been to Melbourne recently because I stalked you on Facebook.
Yeah.
I said.
And, love my Melbourneites.
I was living down that way, and we had to go to Ballarat. So the night before, I knew we had an early start, and I said, oh, I'll go to bed and I'll have a read. And I just started reading, and I had these two people come through. Uncle Ted and Auntie Flo, I think, from memory, and they just chatted and chatted and chatted, and they were so full on. It was like I didn't get to sleep at all, and they had all these messages. Anyway, they weren't saying who they were connected to, but I thought it might well be the lady for the next day. So I said to Brian, you know, remind me why I do this for you. When he picked me up. And we drove to Ballarat, and we got to this lady's house, and I said to her, you don't have any relatives called Uncle Ted and Auntie Flo, do you? And she said, oh, I wondered whether they might come through. Well, they were very definitely through.
I love, though, the pre-conversation that people who are somewhat skeptic have with their relatives that have passed away. And then when they say stuff like that, it's just such a good thing, because you deep down know that those people really do believe. It's just, I don't know why, it's just a society thing that what we do is scary, if you know what I mean. Sorry to cut you off.
Oh, my children think I'm super scary.
That's a good thing in your case, though, because but in my case, I don't have any kids. Everyone just thinks I'm scary. So,
yeah, but when they think you're scary, it's good. From my point of view, I remember when my children were growing up, Rhys, and it was like, there's no point lying to the old girl because she's going to know. So that one worked well. And my the general joke in my family is Mum doesn't really need a car. We'll just get the Kickstarter fixed on her broom. And I haven't quite convinced them that there's a difference between Wicca and being, you know, following the Wiccan path and being called a witch.
Yes.
And what I do is quite different. And recently, early this year, my daughter sent me a photo on Facebook of this. She collects, buys miniature ponies.
Oh, yeah.
Tiny little silver grey pony, and his name's Spirit. And he's 9 years old, so his name's been Spirit for 9 years. And she said, "Hey, Mother, this is your new mode of transport. His name's Spirit." And she had her hand on his head, and I said, "Oh, he looks like a little unicorn. Get your hand off him. Can't see his unicorn horn. Where's all his sparkles?" So I claimed the pony. I said, "Well, you just said he's mine, so you can't get rid of him now. He belongs to me." and he's got, according to my daughter, he's got good daughter-in-law. He's got fat ankles and he's ugly. He's actually not. He's very cute. But he's got very much a mind of his own, so he fits very well for me.
I love it. I love it.
So I'm actually going to write a series of kids' stories about the little pony who was actually a unicorn, just for fun.
Oh, yay. I love it. Yay. Make sure you illustrate it. I can see these fantastic illustrations already.
Yeah, I started a book some years ago. I haven't finished it. I've got a number of books. I haven't finished it. Called The Wellvania Chronicles, which is the story of a wizard and a community of elves, and it's kind of like a reverse Harry Potter.
Right.
That I, you know, put on the back burner for a while that I need to get back to. So let's come back to you, Rhys. 17, you had some realizations. Did it start earlier than that?
Look, speaking of my grandfather, the dear old thing, I love picking on him. But
I'll tell him you know that, don't you?
Yeah, I know. This is so going to get back to me. But anyways, so when I was 17, I would never, ever forget this. I can remember it. I can paint it for you. I can write it in a book still. That's how simultaneous I can remember things these days. It's amazing. But at the same time, I have very bad short-term memory. And I think that's a psychic thing I'm tuning into recently. But anyways, so I was 17. I was experiencing a lot of I'd say hectic emotions for a 17-year-old. I wasn't living at home at the time. I was pretty much being an adult, but I've always been like that. I've always been ahead of my age in that sense. So it's never felt weird to me, but for everybody else has always pedestaled it and kind of gone, you know, you were so amazing in that time kind of thing, but it's weird. Anyways, so I started looking online just because I was feeling and confirming with people that I was actually feeling empathically their emotions. And I had a few experiences at my workplace that weren't too pleasant, where my first one, I actually felt the need to want to do something that I didn't really want to do. Mm-hmm. Another time at that workplace, because these moments I remember back to as my kind of kickstarting moments, if you know what I mean. They gave me the initial passion. I remember another girl challenged me, and this is a big lesson that Spirit taught me, not to, you know, fuddy-duddy around with you, with what they've given you to play around with, if you know what I mean. You've got to use it wisely. But this girl said, "Oh, you can't read me. You're a liar. You're a liar." And I said, "Come on, I'll meet you at lunch." So we did. And everyone from work came, and it was a big, you know, bit of a show. And it was scary for me because that was the first time I actually picked up on someone that was dead. And it scared the crap out of me, but I was just going with it. And I just went, you know what? This feels amazing. And I got instantly addicted to what I now know of being on that vibration. So from there, how this ties in with my grandfather is because he somehow knew. And I now know this because he believes we come from Native Americans on his side.
Yep.
So And he called me literally 2 weeks around this time. It was so close to it. It was spooky. And he said, oh, you've got something I've got. And I will never forget his words, because I was walking around IGA doing my shopping and I was there for about an hour and a half. I swear they thought I was like thieving because I was so into the conversation with Pop. And that's when I realized, wow, this is real. It's real. It's physical. It's in the third dimension, because that's what I'd always said. If I saw it, and I did, I saw it in front of my own eyes with my own, you know, what I now know as my third eye, and seeing is believing. That's all I can say. So, and that's basically how it all started. And from there it's rolled and it's snowballed. And now I can never take it away from who I am. You will never know me as Rhys without my intuition, because that's just who I am.
And that's the really big part of it, isn't it? I was about 3 when I started.
Wow.
That I remember. You know, it may have been earlier, but we moved house when I was 2. And I know it was after we moved house that I started seeing people. And because I would say to my parents, my mother especially, my father was away in London at university a lot, you know, the lady over there, for example, said, and my mother would say, there is no lady over there, Sheila. And I'd say, well, yeah, there is. You know, she's got a green coat on and she's wearing a hat and she's got apples in her basket. And I'd go to your room.
And you're like, what even? Like, just happened. She was there.
And then my grandmother used to take me to the spiritualist church with her. I used to spend weekends with her and my grandfather, my father's parents. So, you know, on my mother's side, I'm Scots and Irish. And on my father's side, my grandmother was Welsh and my grandfather came from the Isle of Man. So originally they were gypsies from Europe, probably Spain, Romani kind of thing. So I got that whole Celtic thing. I don't know what they thought they were going to get when they got me, but I don't think it was me. So Nan used to take me to the spiritualist church with her when I was little, you know, like 4 or 5. And on the way home, she'd be saying, holding my hand, and she'd say to me, "Now, we won't be telling you, ma'am, now, will we, Sheila Ann?" And I've often looked back and thought, you know, Nan, were you teaching me to tell fibs, or were you teaching me that you can't talk to everybody? And I'm pretty sure it was the can't talk to everybody. But it took a long time for it to sink into me to shut up.
Me too. I still have problems with it. What are you talking about?
Well, I probably do too. And we went to East Africa when I was 8, so long way from England, long way from I was stuck with my mother, which wasn't a good situation at all. And I was about 10 and I got up one morning and I said at breakfast time, Nanny Scott, which was my mother's mother, was sitting on the side of my bed talking to me at 2 o'clock this morning. And I know it was 2 o'clock because I got up to go to the bathroom and so on. I looked at the clock and my mother did the usual, don't be ridiculous, Sheila. She has this very upper class English voice, you know, dear. And, you know, if you're going to have nightmares, do not eat biscuits before you go to bed. And that was the end of the conversation. Shut up, Sheila. So my father went off to work, and of course Africa's a big distance time-wise from the UK.
Yeah.
And he came home at morning tea time to say there was a telegram to say my mother's mother had passed away, which would have been around the time she was talking to me. So my mother dealt with that by not speaking to me for 3 weeks.
You know, I've seen similar situations. I know exactly, and it's so tough. Because I'm curious to know how you felt towards your mum, because sometimes get stuck in this state where I feel guilty for being annoyed because I just feel like, you know what, that person really didn't mean it anyway. Like, I don't know. Do you know what I mean? It's
very much, yes.
Oh, it pains me because all I want to do is just be angry and I can't, because I just can't. I just have this love and compassion and just want to go, you know what, you stuffed up, but we all get a second chance. Let's go. Do you know what I mean?
We do all get a second chance, but I'm one of those line in the sand people.
Right. Yes, of course. There's always the line.
You get a certain number of chances, but when you've stepped over that line, there's no going back.
Of course.
And I... Like, it's 55 years since I was 10. I'm 65 now. So I haven't spoken to my family in about 35 years.
Wow.
Purely and simply because I am who I am and I can't be who they want me to be. So I'm the black sheep of the family. They're all nurses. My father's passed, but he taught nursing. My mother was a nursing sister. Two of my three sisters are nurses. And I'm that woman who does all that other stuff.
But you know what? I don't you kind of love being that person?
Because I do.
I'm that person and I love it because I stand out from a mile and I've always just, it sounds terrible. I'm a bit of a narcissist, got to admit, guys, but at least I can admit it. But I've always loved attention since I was a kid and it didn't really, like, and I've just learned to play with that in a positive manner, if you know what I mean. You just, you kind of go, ooh, people are looking at me. What can I do with that? You know, how can I impact the world?
I would have run away. I was so incredibly shy.
Wow.
When I was a child. I used to run away and hide if someone I didn't know spoke to me. So yeah, we've got the absolute opposite.
Yeah, well, it takes all types to be in our job, as I like to
Absolutely. So when you found that 17, because age is people interest me, Rhys, because as I said, I was very young. My youngest son was very young. He was only 4 when he started commenting on being, you know, the people being there that he could see and talk to and things like that. The rest of my children, I have 5 of them, have very little going on for them on that level. They're very human, if you like.
Yes.
And as you were saying before about standing out, I often explain it to people. It's like some people are in kindergarten, some are in primary school, some are in high school, some are in university, some have been and done it all and come back again. And to me, you fit in the you've been and done it all and come back again.
Look, I don't want to sound up myself, but yes, I feel a bit like that. So I really do. Like it just feels like I have to do something with the world. Like I have to. It's like I'm now to the point where I've convinced myself that much that I'm going to impact the world. It's like I personally want to almost meet as many people as I can. Just to give every person a hug and just go, you know what? Everyone has a bad day, but here's a smile or a hug. Do you know what I mean? It's just, that's all I want to do in this world is just impact it, make people think, get people thinking on just a different perspective to what they're currently on. Because as one of my favorite peeps in the world, Albert Einstein, has always said, and a lot of people should know this quote, it is, if you're going to continue to do the same thing over and over again and expect a different result, that's actually the definition of insanity.
I like that. So,
you think I'm crazy? Well, you're insane. Stop doing the same thing over and over again, everyone, and expecting it to change. And you know what? Even I struggle with it sometimes, but I laugh at myself when I do it now because I go, here's you telling everyone about all the mechanics of the universe and all this jazz, and you sometimes you trip and fall, but that's what it's all about. You trip, fall, get back up, keep walking. That's all.
It's having that human experience.
That's
isn't it?
Right. You have to. That's why you're here. We're not in the third dimension just so we can channel into the fourth dimension. What would be the point?
Well, I've often said to people, you know, I've been told that Earth is the harshest school in the universe. And, you know, I often say to people, we come here as a soul or a spirit. We've got a human bodysuit, whether we like it or not. And it's not always very comfortable putting that very large soul-spirit connection into that very small bodysuit. And it's why a lot of people are very uncomfortable being here in that physicality. And, you know, the Sheila version is always a Sheila version, is that when we leave here, we go home. Heaven, soul, consciousness, the I am, the all that there is, whatever you want to call it. I call it the coffee shop in the sky because I think it's much more.
I love that.
Much more fun to have a cappuccino.
Because I love coffee and I'm a barista.
Oh, there you go. I think it's much more fun to have a cappuccino or a latte than just to float around on a damp lab. So we sit around in that coffee shop in the sky, and obviously you and I have met before because we wouldn't be having this conversation if we hadn't.
Absolutely. That's correct.
Yep. And we make what I call soul contracts. So let's meet up. And, I mean, what's the chances of my moving to a mountain in the middle of nowhere, basically, 11 months ago almost, and meeting your grandfather?
Absolutely. But
and allowing how I've lived here 11 months and I know your grandfather, my landlord, and the people across the road and the people beside me, and that's it on this mountain. In 11 months. So, you know, there has to be that bigger picture, doesn't there? And then when we've made all those soul contracts, again, the Sheila version, we go next door to the supermarket and they have better trolleys than we do and the wheels run really nicely and so on. And there's all these packages and they're all full of emotions and they're all free. So if you're going to experience love or joy, you must experience sadness or something similar because you need to have that balance. And it might be 80-20, 60-40, it doesn't really matter. But you load it all into that supermarket trolley, all these, oh, I haven't tried that, I wouldn't mind some of that, and that'll do. Yep. And you get to the checkout and the angel or whatever you see on the checkout says, hey, you know, Sheila, you sure you want to take all that with you? And you go, oh, look, I've got it down pat. And you come through that revolving door and you land here. And you think, what on earth did I do? And I've been using that explanation for a very, very long time. But as you said, as I said when I was stalking you on Facebook, whether we call it the Akashic Records or... Mm-hmm.
I'm in your boat. I don't care what you call it.
Well,
it is what it is. That's right.
And that universal knowledge...
That's right.
That's available. And not to everybody, let's be realistic, but people like yourself.
There's a scale.
Can tap
there
into
is a
that.
Scale.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's still, well, the way, what I like to say to everyone all the time is there's balance. So if there's someone that's incredibly smart, there's someone that's incredibly dumb. So it has to happen like that. That's just the way it is. And that's the way everyone's souls have incarnated and chosen and agreed to all incarnate at this point in time, because otherwise the universe wouldn't be the universe without all of those things going on.
Exactly.
And it's just like when you say that to people, they actually stop and go, oh, that was a bit heavy. Like, that was a heavy statement. And then they think about the actual simplicity of the statement. And then it's just like, yeah, guys, you can be a part of this if you so choose to be. That's the bliss of it all. I don't care if you don't like what I'm doing, because you don't have to like it and you don't have to listen or, you know, affiliate. I just love that part about being, you know, being in the culture of being yourself. And I think that's what I want to socially call the metaphysical or whatever you want to call it, psychic mediums, all of those general people. It's just the being in the culture of being yourself, your 100% true you. And that's all I feel we're supposed to hear, like we're supposed to just teach people, is to be yourself. That's all.
And that's one of the hardest things, isn't it, for some people?
Absolutely.
Because we're so programmed, and this is a bit of a soapbox for me, but we're programmed from prior to being born. Mm-hmm. So you've got, you know, all the beliefs coming through the family line for a start, and then you've got what mum was thinking while you were in utero and what people around her were saying, and you've got that whole birth, which to me is the biggest trauma we ever experienced. And so on. And then you've got all that programming of, you know, being told what you can and can't do, how you should and should behave, what's coming through the television and, you know, the indoctrination from my perspective. And then you go to school and it starts again and you get told, you know, boys don't do this and girls don't do that. And, you know, if you struggle with something, well, you're never going to learn. Of course, children believe what they're told. And you've got all of that stuff that you take on and, you know, gets lodged in your mind, gets filtered, as I call it, and it creates that belief about who you are or why you are. And it takes a really strong individual to be like you are, from my perspective, and say,
thank you,
this is who I am. this is what I know. This is who I not just want to be, but need to be, because it is a burn, isn't it?
Oh, it's like the more I go against what I do, and this has happened to me, that I've just been a part of this whole big debacle in the third dimension, if I will call it. And I feel like this happens to the people who need to be the people like us, the light workers. I feel like it always happens to us the hardest first, so that we can go, yep, okay, we understand it. Now let's teach, because these people are going to suffer and it's going to hit them hard, and we just need to be there. I feel like we're the safety net. So, and it's weird, because on a daily basis, I still get anxiety. I still get social anxiety. I get weird with people, but I always am constantly, because it's like an OCD habit for me now to go snap out of it. What do you look at the sun? It's beautiful. Like, you're breathing. What's your problem? What's wrong? Like, what is actually wrong? You're standing, like, I work at McDonald's now, and that was a choice. And I love that I tell people that that was my choice to go back working from an insurance company to McDonald's. Yep. And amongst other things that I'm doing, it's just convenient. And I love being able to brighten people's day. So, and on a daily basis, that, like, I feel like I can impact more people at McDonald's than I can anywhere else, which is quite funny.
Do you know, I have a young friend of mine. She's just about to turn 18, and she works at McDonald's. And I think what a joy she is in people's lives, you know. And seriously, from my perspective, I don't eat McDonald's, but that's choice. But they have, I believe they have one of the best management systems as far as training people.
Yes.
So, you know, it's a very good basis if you're looking for a job somewhere else to say you've been trained by McDonald's.
Well, it's actually funny you mentioned that, because I know actual facts and statistics behind that, because I have done courses through McDonald's, because I previously worked there over the course of the last 8 years on and off. And I've worked at about 8 or 9 different stores. I know where head office is, all that jazz. So, but McDonald's Australia training is actually world renowned and recognized.
Yes.
And McDonald's Australia is home of McCafe. We actually invented that. So,
So that's pretty awesome, isn't it?
It is. And, well, just the things that McDonald's teach you that actually stuck with me, and even within my readings, just professionalism, being able to interact with strangers, that is such an important tool, I feel, for people. Because even in those daily moments where I do feel that anxiety, I kind of click straight into that compassion. You know, what's this person really here for? How can I help them? How can I make their day a bit better?
Yeah.
And it doesn't take that much. It really doesn't. A smile.
It doesn't. And I actually wrote about this. Now, I don't know if you know, Rhys, but Susan, my colleague, and I are about to release, hopefully next week or so, an anxiety challenge.
Ooh.
So we're giving away, it's called the 7 Steps to Freedom. We're giving away a series of things as a download, because anxiety has been a really big passion of mine for many, many years. And we've also got a community on Facebook called Anxiety Need Not Be a Life Sentence, to support that program. Now, my reasoning for working with anxiety, I realized in the early 2000s that probably 95% of the people that I worked with as clients, you know, in being a holistic practitioner, had anxiety from conception. And you mentioned a couple of really interesting things, because anxiety was the very first sound I ever created when I started playing with sound programs. But I actually have 18 different sound programs based around 18 different anxieties. And that social anxiety is one of the huge things. And another one is performance anxiety. So there's a whole series of things. So I've combined 7 different anxieties into the one sound.
And I love that. I love that. I actually think you're the queen of sound. I keep telling people, oh my gosh, I've met the queen of sound, because that's honestly the vibration I feel from you without even having an interaction, if you know what I mean.
Thank you.
That's what I feel, you just resonate with sound.
Oh,
so well.
I just love it. And it does, it resonates. And So there's a in the seven things, there's a book and some sounds and a meditation. And as I said, we're going to give them away. So I'll send you an invite to the community. And
please do.
Yeah, because I'm just really, really excited about it. And I find that so many people who work as we do as psychic mediums, intuitives and so on, actually quite often have anxiety.
Yes, yes, because otherwise how would we know how to deal with it?
Well, the other thing too is I think it's not, as we said before, Jane, before about putting someone on a pedestal, but you tend to vibrate at a different mm-hmm. level energetically. And I wasn't born with anxiety. I say to people, conceptual anxiety means at conception, mum and dad were worried about it. Probably thinking about something else at the time. We won't go there.
Yeah.
But, you know, if we create a baby, are we going to make good parents, et cetera, et cetera.
Of course.
Well, I didn't have that.
Right.
But I developed anxiety through my childhood, what I would call learned anxiety and transference anxiety and social anxiety and performance anxiety. You know, I shoved on a stage and made to learn to ballet dance and tap dance because I was so shy. They, thought that it would be good for me to interact with other people. It was horrific. I couldn't stand it. But there's so many of these anxieties, and I have spiritual anxiety and so on. And again,
yes.
Death, mortality, anxiety.
I'm so glad you brought up especially the latter two, because people probably wouldn't even expect that there is spiritual anxiety. I get anxious going to readings sometimes, not anymore, to be honest, but as recent as probably 4 months ago, 5 months ago, I was still getting nervous. I was like, "Oh, are they going to show up today?" It's like stage fright. I feel like that's how you could compare it, is stage fright.
Well, I know for me growing up, I moved country, moved schools, you name it. I detested going somewhere I hadn't been before, going into a shop that I hadn't been into before. There was that whole, am I going to affect their electrics? Because I've got a habit of not so much in early days with cash registers, where you push the buttons, but the electronic ones quite often don't like me. and zapping people, the static electricity, all those kinds of things as well. But also being people sometimes, and I'm sure you get as well, not just because you like being flamboyant perhaps, but people look at you and then they look again because they see something but they're not sure what they're seeing.
Do you know what though? I do test this and I may come across as a very flamboyant, but as I was just kind of having a say in the chat room, it's because I'm really excited. Like I'm just so excited and
yeah.
It kind of turns up a notch. It's weird and I can't control it, to be honest, but I've learned just to go with it because it turns itself down. But in public, I've tested exactly what you were just talking about and it's incredible. Last weekend, I went out with some friends, everybody in the nightclub with blaring music, moved out of my way like I was Moses, and I was like, what are you people doing? That made me feel anxious because I was like, what are they doing? And everyone just parted the way and they weren't doing it for anyone else, just for me, and all my friends were just walking behind me. And it's incredible how your energy can actually affect other people without them even knowing it. And this is why I like to always tell people, I try to remember to tell people anyway, to cleanse, 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 and make sure you're not carrying other people's baggage.
Oh, so, so much, yes.
Because I feel like as much as we want to be friends with people sometimes, we also need to learn when like you were saying before, where's the boundary? Where does this kind of, because if there's no you and you're not taking care of you and there's not enough balance in your life, how is there going to be enough balance in, your life to be able to assist other people to find balance in their life?
Well,
I'll
share something with you that happened to me yesterday and today that you'll probably find funny. I went to a networking lunch up here on the Gold Coast yesterday. Yep. It was one I'd been invited to, I hadn't been to before, and they said, it's at a tavern. So, okay, I'm not a pub person. I don't drink. There's a reason why I don't drink. So I turn up and there's 75 people for this networking lunch and it's in a sports bar. And the noise level's quite loud and I, as you know, live on the mountain and live alone. Yeah. So I live very silently. Did not have television, and I did this mental, okay, put some extra barriers up, because if you take the top off a bottle of wine, you've just lost me. Mm-hmm. It's like I don't need to drink it. You just need to lift the lid.
Yeah.
So I'm there for 2 hours, and I'm surrounded by 75 people. Now, I'd say probably 50 of those people were having something alcoholic. So at the end of the 2 hours, it was like, I've got to get out of here because I'm not going to be able to drive if I don't.
Yeah.
So I got out to the car and it was quite hot here yesterday. We're, you know, Queensland tends to have, as you know, winter and summer. We don't tend to have a spring and an autumn.
Yes, yes.
So I drove back to where I work. I come down the mountain and work one day a week and thought, I'm so tired. And I sat in the chair in my office and closed my eyes and went to sleep. And then I had to go out again to a networking dinner last night where there's no alcohol, which is really good. And it was 7 o'clock when I got home. So I'd been gone from 7 in the morning till 11 last night. And I got up this morning and I'm looking around and it's like, I can't even, what on earth's wrong with me? And it was like I had a hangover.
Right, right.
Now, I've been slightly inebriated 3 times in my life.
Wow.
Drinking a long time ago, you know, probably 35, 38 years ago. That's the only thing I could think of. It's like I'm getting over being drunk and yet I don't drink. So that's the sensitivity that people like you and I can have.
Yes, absolutely. Oh, on another level do I understand where you're coming from, because I've experienced very, very, I call it odd, only because it's the best way to explain it to people so that I'll understand, because that's the only way I can describe it, is kind of just, it's odd because I feel what other people are feeling from a far distance, and it's been happening ever since I've switched on. Since 17, for example, and this may be a bit TMI, but me and all my girl best friends, every time, I always knew when it was that time of the month for them. Yep. I would literally call them all and be like, I'm not happy. I'm eating chocolate or I'm doing something that's not within my regular behavior.
Yes, what's because you're picking up on other people, yeah.
But what's even more amazing, I find now, is that I actually think I've affected all my friends and made them all align. And these are people that don't know each other. So I think that's so strange, because they all text me about it now. And they're just like, I'm like, how is this all happening at the same time every month? Like, is it the time? But apparently, so yeah, but that's a funny, quirky story for you.
Well, it's very interesting that our young friend Tiny's in the chat room, and you know Tiny from Facebook as a connection of mine, being rude about me being the BJJ granny. I do have a T-shirt she bought me that says "Stay calm and choke a fool."
I'm trying to keep up. Who is Tiny? Tiny, can you reveal yourself, please? But anyway, sorry.
Tiny's and my Tina Louise from Pink Rose Healing.
Oh, hello.
She, as I said, she was on with me a couple of weeks ago. And it's all you wonderful young people, yes. So, but it's that whole, you know, Tiny can be in Melbourne, Tina, who calls me Mama She, and I can be here and pick up on her, or she will contact me and say, are you okay? And, you know, when we do have those connections with people, I was actually talking to a friend of mine today in the US, and I knew there was something wrong, which is why we made contact and things like that. It was just, I just need to touch base with them.
Yes.
So when you are in tune and you are sensitive and you do pick up on so much around you. Living, you know, here on the mountain, I was talking to your grandfather a few weeks ago about how the energy's changed since January.
Yes. Oh, hasn't it? And it's not just, oh, it's global. It's so powerful too.
Mm.
So powerful.
And, you know, so much all around us. And I know you mentioned Mercury retrograde just before we came on air. And I know I was talking to Tiny about it the other week. And, you know, lots of people say, oh, you know, don't make, you know, travel arrangements, don't do this, don't do that, et cetera, et cetera. But there's so much more that's deeper, isn't there, when you're looking at those levels?
Absolutely. And I've spent the last four, since I've been fully aware of what Mercury retrograde is and the full effects of it, what and what you can do with it for yourself, I've been pushing my or my close friend circle to do it for themselves. And do you know what? This will be probably the first Mercury retrograde. I can count on two hands the amount of people that are sorting through the things that they're tying up their loose ends. Because that's how I like to explain it to people now, is Mercury retrograde is, think of it as a way to help you tie up those loose ends that you, the emotional loose ends, sorry, I should clarify, that you haven't really wanted to tie up and you've let them go and just ignored them. That's what I find that Mercury retrograde is best for, is tying those loose ends up. And basically, once you do that, you feel lighter. And that's when you transcend, I believe, in, you know, onto the next vibration. You know, your vibration rises that little bit extra. And that's, and not only does your vibration do it, but the whole world does it. The whole universe does it. The vibration shifts everywhere. That's how powerful every single person is. And it's just like, if you could just amplify that, because I know when I tell people that, I don't always see people get as excited as I get about that. And I'm like, why aren't you excited about that? You're that powerful. You're affecting the planets that you don't even know about. You're affecting things you don't even know about. That's how powerful we all are as individuals. So why do we waste our time on first world problems? Hashtag.
Look, there's so much. And I was talking to someone a few weeks ago, and they said, you know, the energy, the balance has shifted. I mean, it's been shifting for a long time. But the more people that become aware, the more people that are, you know, energetically working towards, I often sign off on things with peace, love and light. And, you know, lots of people put love and light, and lots of people put namaste, and I have a bit of an issue.
It's very common now.
I have a bit of an issue with that one. But I also have an issue with the word psychic, and I have an issue with the word channel. And I do both, as you
do.
Because I think they're so overused.
To be honest, I always come between two minds. Like, I'm always struggling to find the best word for it, because I feel like the word psychic has been tarnished for centuries. So I don't feel like that's going to recover anytime soon, anytime quick. Mm-hmm. And that's a historical fact because I've researched it. And in terms of channels, I think there's not enough knowledge out there about what channels are, what they do, what they're capable of. You know, I just think because people don't know, they fear it automatically.
We'll be going to a break in about 3 or 4 minutes, but when we come back, we might explore that if you like.
Oh, absolutely.
I think that would be a really good thing to have a look at, because, and also the word psychic, because so many people misuse it.
Yes, please, let's do this.
I think that's because, you know, the shows are archived, so people who aren't able to listen in can join the archives. I'll be saying on the break for a whole $4.95 cup of coffee price, not $495, as someone thought I meant. You can go in and access the archives of all of the shows. And I think that's just the best $4.95 a month that I ever spent to, you know, be able to go in and listen to things in my time when I want to, or when I'm able to, and things like that. And so we know that not only does the show go out to many, many people, but there are also many people who go in and listen to the archives. And if this is the, for me, you know, I've had people say to me, what are you doing, Sheila? You know, look at all these doctors who are holistic doctors mm-hmm. who are getting bumped off and so on. You're out there talking about aliens and UFOs and stuff. You know, the stuff that people your age shouldn't really be talking about, et cetera, et cetera. You know, don't you think that's pretty crazy? And it's like, if I don't talk about it, who's going to?
Yeah.
And if I don't share, who's going to?
That's
but it's also, for me, just been a wonderful way of connecting with people, having some amazing guests like yourself, and being able to share that knowledge that that unless you really know what you're looking for, there's so much, isn't there, on the internet that you can go and find, but how much of it is really real?
Well, I like to think of a much like the opposite to your show's name, I'd like to think of it more as a 99-to-1 scale, as in 99% of it's crap and 1% of it's real. So
exactly.
That's what I keep in mind all the time. And I try and teach people how to filter through the crap too, because it's recognisable. It's so recognisable at first glance to me now. Yeah. I look at it and I go, no, no. No. And then I find the right one and I go, no, this is it. And I have people question that sometimes very quickly before the break, sorry. I have people question that and go, oh, but you're just selecting it. But I'm not. I know I can prove it because I keep records.
And I think, no, in knowing yourself and knowing, as you said before, when you are in tune, your body vibrates at a different energy. So you know whether something feels right or not.
Yeah, you can feel it immediately because it feels wrong to your core, it'll make you.
There's our break. We'll be back shortly.
No way.
Things were not quite right, that everything was just ever so slightly askew.
Do you have, to paraphrase Morpheus, a splinter in your mind?
If you're interested in hearing the latest information about UFOs, the paranormal,
ancient cultures and structures,
monatomic elements,
longevity,
fantastic discoveries in science,
download it to your brain,
then tune in to us. Hi, I'm Dave.
And I'm Mackie.
And we are Shiny Side Out, Sundays 2 to 4 a.m. Eastern. See you then.
Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. You don't need to expect us. We're already here.
Hi, this is Bo.
And this is Rocco.
And the Bo and Rocco Show is here to offer insight into legal and lawful remedies. Our goal is to remain free and help others remain free in an ever-increasing police-like state. With the help of our guests, we try to answer questions such as what went wrong and what can we do about it.
So tune in to Revolution Radio at www.freedomslips.com Wednesday nights, 10 to 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time to listen to the Bo and Rocco Show.
You don't need to expect us.
We're already here.
Revolution Radio.
If you glimpsed the future and were frightened by what you saw, what would you do with that information? You would go to who? Politicians? Captains of industry? And how would you convince them? Data? Facts? Good luck. The only facts they won't challenge are the ones that keep the wheels greased and the dollars rolling in. But what if What if there was a way of skipping the middleman and putting the critical news directly into everyone's head? The probability of widespread annihilation kept going up. The only way to stop it is to show it. Scare people straight. Because what reasonable human being wouldn't be galvanized by the potential destruction of everything they've ever known or loved? To save civilization, I would show its collapse. How do you think this vision was received? How do you think people responded to the prospect of imminent doom? They gobbled it up like a chocolate eclair. They didn't fear their demise, they repackaged it. It can be enjoyed as video games, as TV shows, books, movies, the entire world wholeheartedly embraced the apocalypse and sprinted towards it with gleeful abandon. Meanwhile, Earth was crumbling all around you. You've got simultaneous epidemics of obesity and starvation.
Catch you on the flip side.